Okay. You can see the slide now, right?
Yeah, sir.
Okay. So let me also make it full screen. Now this is about theory stands. Now is oxymoron. So oxymoron, you know, so this interesting English word where two completely opposite words in that and in the varying constant. Okay, so this is the rough plan of my talk. So first I will tell you about the fundamental constant. So what do we mean by fundamental constant? What is the definition of fundamental constant and some examples of fundamental constants? And then I'll tell you the classifications. So you can actually classify or categorize this fundamental constant in different ways in terms of their dimension or in terms of their role in physics. So this classification I also tell you a little bit about, and then I will also tell you about different unit systems and your natural unit system. So these unit systems are actually introduced in a specific context where you have this conversion are easier to do depending on the theory you are working on. So different unit system might be helpful. Then I introduce something called varying electromagnetic coupling. So this electromagnetic coupling, in other word, is fine structure constant that we all know it's a dimensionless constant. How is dimensionless constant, fine structure constant, can vary? Now, in context of particle physics, it has some interesting consequences. So this theory can predict some new particles, scalar particles in the spectrum of this theory. And I will also a little bit talk about that. Maybe some generalization to the actual SU3, SU2 cross. Standard model, gauge theory, and the corresponding group is this. And fine structure constant idea in context to standard, and then some signatures, how you can actually see the signature of these models. So this is the brief plan. Okay, so the fundamental constant or the physical constant. So what do we mean by physical constant? So a parameter of the theory. So this is a parameter of the theory which cannot be explained by the theory itself. And you can only measure this parameter in experiments. So these are basically called physical constant. And some example are listed here, not exhaustive list. Some important example like rest mass of an electron, which we know that 9.1 into 10 to the power minus 31 kg. And then Newton's gravitational constant, velocity of light in vacuum. And there are other constants like Rydberg constant, fine structure constant, so many constants are there in physics, theoretical physics. Now you notice some constant, like first four constant here I listed, all have dimensions. Now this fine structure constant, this is a dimensionless constant, as I mentioned before. So there are two types of constant you can see here in terms of their dimensions. Now this is unlike the mathematical constant like pi or e. So they have fixed numerical value, and we actually don't talk about the variation of pi or variation of e. that is nonsense. But here, the variation of fine structure constant or the physical constant is not a nonsense concept that you will see now. Now, what are the fundamental physical constant? So this is a physical quantity that is generally believed to be both universal in nature, so that is true for everything, and have constant value in space-time. So they will not vary if you go to some other part of the universe, or if you go to some other era in the cosmological time scale. So they will not vary. So these are known as fundamental constants. Now the next question is that how many fundamental constants we have, or what is the minimal number of fundamental constants we should consider? So that is a good question, and there are a lot of constant you can think of. So a conventional list of fundamental constant could be like electron charge, its mass, proton mass, Planck constant, velocity of light, etc., etc. So all these constant you can actually think of. Now when I ask you about how many fundamental constant we should consider, then you have to specify the context you are talking about. For example, if you consider let's say classical electromagnetism, so the last two constant in this list you can see here, permeability of vacuum and permittivity of the vacuum, so epsilon naught and mu naught. So these two quantities, when you consider classical electromagnetism, like Maxwell theory, so they are, these two are not independent. So they are related by this relation. You can see here at the bottom of this slide, C equal to 1 by square root of mu naught epsilon naught. So that you will get. So in this framework, so this becomes sort of derived constant. So they depends on each other. Some relation exists. So you have to specify the context when you ask this question, how many fundamental constants are there. Okay, now our context or our area is standard model of particle physics. So when we talk about standard model, so this is the brief overview of the standard model. So standard model consists of different type of particles, and some of them are fermions, which are like spin half particle, and some of them are spin one particle or gauge boson. They are the carriers of the different forces, fundamental interactions of forces. And then the last piece, which was discovered in 2012 but predicted like in 1960s, is the Higgs boson. So that we all know that this is responsible to give mass to the particles, other particles of the standard model. Now in fermion category, you have two types of fermions, like quarks and leptons. Then there are six types of quarks possible, and in lepton there are two types of leptons, like charged lepton and neutron or neutrinos. And there are three different generations of these leptons. So the first column is basically the first generation, and the second column is the second generation, and the third column is the third generation, and so on. Now these gauge bosons, as I said, they are the force carrier. So when you exchange these particles, then you feel the force. So these are the force carrier. For example, photon is the carrier of electromagnetic force. Similarly, gluon is the carrier of strong force, and these other two particles, Z boson and W bosons, they are the carrier of weak force. So this is the structure of the standard model or particle spectrum of the standard model. And as I said before, the gauge group of the standard model, so it is a gauge theory, and probably you all know what is gauge theory. And the gauge group is basically this SU3 that is related to the strong interaction part, and the SU2 that is related to the weak interaction part, and then the U1 that is related to the electromagnetic part. So this is the gauge group of the standard model. Okay, now I can ask this similar question: how many parameters or constants are there in the standard model? So this list I have taken from Wikipedia, and if you count them, you will see 19 such parameters are listed here. So they are not calculated from the theory. So only at max you can measure these parameters from experiments. So that is the thing you can do only. So 19 such parameters, among them the masses of these particles, as I showed in the previous slide, different fermions. So these fermion masses are also parameter. So in terms of coupling, you can actually express these masses. So these couplings are called Yukawa couplings, and they are dimensionless. So this 19 number you can see here, that contains these Yukawas. That means these Yukawa couplings. And as you have seen in the previous slide, there are three gauge group associated with the standard model. So each gauge group has a different gauge coupling. So this U1, SU2 and SU3. So three different gauge couplings you need to introduce. So these are also parameter of the standard model. Then there are certain other parameters. So total 19 such parameter present in the standard model. Now you can extend this standard model, because we have seen in experiment that these neutrinos, they have very tiny but non-zero mass, which is not a prediction of the standard model. So this is an experimental fact. So if you want to consider this neutrino sector, massive neutrino sector in the standard model, then you need to introduce some more parameters. For example, three neutrinos are present, so you need to introduce three masses, and these neutrinos can mix among each other. So three mixing angle also you need to introduce, and one phase you can introduce in the mixing matrix. So total 7 new parameter you need to introduce. So this 19 will become 26 if you just consider this neutrino mixing and the masses. Then if you extend to include the cosmological constant, then you have to increase one more, and standard model of cosmology is there. So then this number becomes higher and higher, like 31 to 37, depending on different context. You can actually have this many free parameters. Now, as I said, this is a very context dependent statement. For example, you can actually think of grand unified theory. So they are these three gauge coupling, as I mentioned, G1, G2 and G3 corresponding to three gauge group in the standard model. They are not independent. So they are related through this relation. So this alpha I is related to the ith gauge coupling, and this MU is the very high scale where this grand unification of these forces, different forces, happens. So in terms of this, you can express all these three gauge couplings. So here this BI is some constant that is related to different models. So if you specify the model, so BIs are known. So you can actually see these couplings are related to each other. Okay. Now, how we can classify these fundamental constants, or are some constant are more fundamental than the others? So in 1979, Levi Leblanc, he pointed out that all constants of physics do not play the same role, and some have a much deeper role than others. So he actually classified this fundamental constant into three categories. So class A, in which in this class the constant characteristic of a particular system. And class B, here this constant characteristics of a class of physical phenomena. And in class C, they are truly universal constant. So I'll give you one example. So if you consider the velocity of light, now we know that this is a universal constant. But when this velocity of light was recognized as the speed of photon, so then this is a particular property of this photon, particle photon. So then that should belong in class A, because this is characteristic of a particular system or particular object. Now, when it is realized that in electromagnetic theory, Maxwell theory, this velocity of C appears, then it is promoted to class B. Then it is like a class of physical phenomena that includes this presence of C. Okay. Now, when it is realized that this is the maximum speed possible in the universe, or this is the maximum speed this information can travel, so then it becomes universal quantity. So this is true for everything related to causality, right? So then it is promoted to class C. So the status of a constant can change over the time. So that is the point. Now, this guy Levi Leblond, he also proposed that only three constant can be present in this class C, which is the universal constant. And this category, so this constant are basically this velocity of light in vacuum, and this Planck constant, and the Newton's gravitational constant. So these three he actually took in the class C category. Okay. Now, if you just consider this three universal constant, then actually you can think of this cube of theoretical physics, where depending on different limits of this constant, you can realize different theories. So this cube of theoretical physics first introduced by Bronsted and Gamow. And here you can see, so this three constant, one is the velocity of light in vacuum, which is denoted by C, and this is this red axis, the speed of light. This is one axis. Another axis is the blue axis, that is the Planck constant. And the third axis is the gravitational constant, Newton's gravitational constant. Now, at the origin, when all these are 0, 0, 0, because they have no role. So at this regime, you actually realize classical mechanics, that normal classical mechanics, where all these three constant will not appear. Okay, so there is a typo in the 0, 1C and 0 vertex, so this vertex, the 1 by C should come in the first position, because this is the x-axis. Okay. Okay, so by the way, so this actual axis is not C, actually 1 by C. And the limit is tending to 0, these values. So when 1 by C tending to 0 means C tending to infinity, like that. To 0 means you recover the classic. So when you have 1 by C only and other two are 0, 0, in that regime you recover special relativity. And different vertices like 0, 8, 0, that vertex is related to non-relativistic quantum mechanics and so on. So this is a nice schematic way you can actually realize different regime of the theoretical physics depending on this limit of these constants, limiting values of these constants. This is good. So these three constants therefore have special role in theoretical physics. Okay, now come to this system of units. So we know that this international or SI system of units, so there are this 7 units are introduced, meter, second, kilogram. So these first three are mechanical units, and then this ampere, kelvin, mole and candela. So these seven units are there in the SI system, basic units. Now you can actually construct other units by some combination of these units. All other units are secondary units in this system. Now this is good for some reason, but this is actually very complicated when you realize that only three independent units are enough to specify everything. So for example, Kelvin, which is a unit of temperature, and this is nothing but energy, right? So you can express in principle in terms of mechanical units like length, mass and time, you can express the Kelvin. Similarly, candela, that is basically energy flask, that also you can express in terms of others. And mole is basically numbers, so number of particles, so that has no dimension. Okay, now this status of ampere in the SI system is actually interesting in the sense that if you consider the Coulomb's law, then this electric charge Q, that is related to force, and the vacuum permeability, which is epsilon naught, is just some kind of conversion factor, you can say. So now the dimension of epsilon naught is what? Which is basically Q square M inverse L minus 3 T square. So this is the dimension of epsilon naught, vacuum permeability. Now you can actually think in this way that this new constant epsilon naught that is present in the Coulomb's law is actually not needed. So if you define your dimension of the electric charge as follows. So this Q square, if you define it, is m to the power half, L to the power 3 by 2 and T minus 1. Then there is no need to introduce epsilon naught, a separate thing. And this is what we actually do in Gaussian unit. So there the vacuum permeability is 1 basically. So this logic, if you extend, then you can actually express everything in terms of three mechanical units. And this idea is basically behind the introduction of natural units. And natural units, we all know that this is relevant in quantum field theory or particle physics context, where we take this C and H card equal to 1. And this is first realized by J. Stoney in 1874. So he realized that these three basic units, time, length and mass, can be defined in terms of three independent constants. So in Stoney's natural unit system, you see this time, length and mass, they are expressed in terms of g, gravitational constant, small e, electric charge, and then velocity of light. And this 4 pi epsilon naught is actually introduced for this SI system. Now in this, you can actually take E equal to G equal to C equal to 1. So that is essentially this Stoney's unit. And the Planck unit, there you, this is very similar. Sorry. There also you express in terms of three quantities, parameters like G, H cart and C, these three mechanical units, time, length and mass. And there you assume G equal to C equal to H cut equal to 1. And you can clearly see, if you compare this, then you see they are connected through this dimensionless fine structure constant. So E square by 4 pi epsilon naught H cut C. That is the dimensionless fine structure constant, and value is 1 by 137. And the good thing with this dimensionless constant is that whatever unit system you choose, their numerical value will be same in all, throughout all unit systems. But the other dimension pool quantities, their numerical value will get will be different in different numerical unit system. Okay. Now there are some debates in literature that what we actually call as fundamental constant, whether this C can be treated as fundamental constant or not. So Michael Dapp in this paper, he argued that the only dimensionless constant are fundamental in nature. So like fine structure constant, this is fundamental. But his opinion that in his opinion that velocity of light is not fundamental, because you can actually write the speed of light equal to one light year, which is distance, and divided by year, that is the time. So it is some kind of unit conversion in his opinion. So he is saying that asking whether C has varied over cosmic history is like asking whether the number of liters to the gallon has varied. But there are different opinions about the fundamental constant, which you call as fundamental. So this is not the only opinion. For example, Veneziano, he is string theorist, he argued that in the framework of string theory, one requires only two dimension full fundamental constant, velocity of light and string length. And the other one, like Planck constant, can be given by the string length. So one can express the Planck constant in terms of string length. Now this is all these debates, but we are not going into that debate. But once a set of three independent constant has been chosen as natural unit, like Stoney unit or Planck unit, then all other constant are dimensionless quantities. You can express them. And these dimensionless number have specific numerical values. Now you can actually ask that these numbers are completely contingent, or there are some fundamental theory where you can actually realize, or this constant will automatically naturally arise in these theories. So this is an important question one should address in theoretical physics. Okay, now in quantum field theory or high energy physics, we already know some kind of coupling variation. So what it is? So this coupling constant I showed at the beginning, the gauge coupling for this three different gauge group of the standard model, so G1, G2, G3. So these couplings or other parameters of the standard model, so they are not fixed, in the sense that if you change energy and do experiment at different energy scale, their values will be different. But the meaning or the thing I am discussing here, variation of coupling, is not like this. So this is not the thing I am discussing here. So this is completely different thing I am discussing here. This is not the variation with respect to different energy scale. So this is the variation with respect to space time. So this is completely different, that you should keep in mind. And this idea actually came from this very intelligent guy in 1937, and later a lot of theory developed. So in 1982, this famous physicist Jacob Bekenstein, he proposed a very simple consistent model of varying fine structure constant. And if you are interested, you can actually go to this nice review in this this paper. You see all these discussions. Okay, now maybe we can take some motivation from string theory. I am not going into actually the details of the string theory, but in string theory, there are no fundamental or no free parameters. So all parameters are set by vacuum expectation value of scalar fields. So what do we mean by vacuum expectation value? So you can see here, so you have a particle here and that is sitting inside a potential well. Okay, now if the minimum of this well is at 0,0 position, okay, then this particle will sit at that position, minimum position, global minimum position, and then there is no vacuum expectation value of this particle. Now suppose the form of this potential is something different than this, like this. So here at the 0,0 point, it is not minimum, it is actually maximum, and the minimum is at some non-zero point. Okay, so in this circle you have actually degenerate minimum. On this circle everything is actually all these points are minimum. Now this particle cannot actually stay here because this is maximum unstable point, so it will roll down to some minimum, either this side or that side or this side, any minimum it will choose. And once it rolls down to a minimum point, then the vacuum expectation value of this scalar field becomes non-zero. So that's what we mean by non-zero vacuum expectation value. And by this non-zero vacuum expectation value, in string theory, in some model, you can actually predict all the parameters. And in string theory, these scalar fields are called moduli field. So just take it as name. And the fundamental constant that we are discussing are basically the vacuum expectation values of this moduli field. You can think of in this way. And you can, in principle, if the form of the potential is known, and then you can actually find out the minimum position and the vacuum expectation values, everything in principle you can calculate. So in principle, these fundamental constants are can be calculated from a potential. Now if these scalars, they have dynamics, like they have equation of motion that allow the vacuum expectation value to vary over space-time, then what happens? Then these constants can vary. So this is the main point here. So this constant can vary if there is dynamics associated with this scalar fields, moduli fields. And once this vacuum expectation is frozen at some scale, then if you are below that scale, then you will not see any variation. But if you are above that scale, then you will see this variation of these fundamental constants. So that is the idea. Now if you apply the Lorentz invariance condition here, then the nature of this field must be scalar. So we only talk about then scalar fields. And if you can somehow find out the correct string theory or correct vacuum of the string theory and the potential, then in principle you can predict these parameters. And all parameters are actually locked at their values. Locked means the frozen what I mentioned in previous slide. So that means if you are below that energy scale, if you are in low energy scale, then essentially you will not see any such variation. So it is sort of frozen or locked. Then alternatively, in low energy, what you expect that this variation of coupling is equivalently saying in the spectrum of the theory, you expect some scalar particles. So that they are responsible for this variation. Okay. So if you can somehow observe this scalar particle in particle detector, then you can actually say that, okay, this theory could be right, this kind of exotic theory could be right. So we borrow this main concept of coupling variation from this string theory, and earlier also in particle physics, lot of approaches, famous approaches in string theory actually borrowed, like supersymmetry, extra dimension, all these things are borrowed in particle physics before. and we are considering this concept of moduli field here, and whose couplings are dynamical in nature, so they are not fixed. Now the next question you can ask, okay, I can consider these variations, fine, but what are the bounds on this variation? Can I just arbitrarily vary these things and construct my theory? The answer is of course no, because different experiments are there, like Big Bang nucleosynthesis observations, like cosmic microwave background. Different experiments actually restrict the parameter space of this model, this kind of exotic construction. You cannot just do arbitrarily vary these parameters. Now all these bounds that can potentially restrict the variation of fine structure constant is actually related to the scalar fields that are massless or very light. It cannot restrict too much a massive scalar field from these experiments. And massive scalar field in some sense good in terms of collider, because that massive particle you can actually produce at the colliders, like Large Hadron Collider, and you can actually detect them. If you can produce them copiously, you can of course detect them, and then you can actually say that okay, maybe this theory is in play, it is there in nature. Okay, so these dynamical fields, if you go to high scale, then only you see this variation, as I said, and at low energy you will not see this variation, and these parameter values they are locked. That means the observed fine structure constant that we see today is actually this locked value, or that frozen value that we see. Okay, so this is Maxwell electromagnetism. So I, in this title you see, I said this is constant E electromagnetism. So E means the charge of electron, where this electron charge is constant, or fine structure constant is constant. So in this model, so this is classical electromagnetism, you all know, and there this gauge freedom is there. You can actually express this B in terms of vector potential as this del cross A, and many A is possible that corresponds to same B, and if A has this transformation rule, like A prime is the new A, which is related to A plus gradient of a scalar field, then if you put it here, you will see that this homogeneous Maxwell equation del dot B, that is satisfied. So this is called the gauge transformation, and you all must know these things from your courses, I suppose. Then when you consider this quantum electrodynamics, then this is the Lagrangian of quantum electrodynamics, and psi bar is the psi is the fermion field that interacts with photon. It is basically charged fermion that comes here, and this part is the kinetic energy of the photon in terms of field strength tensor, and this is the covariant derivative you can define here, and the equation of motion will look like this. So these are all known thing to you. Now comes this varying electromagnetism. So this idea is actually proposed by Jacob Bekenstein, as I said before, in 1980. There he considered this charge of electron is function of space time. Okay, E is function of space time, and that is written here E naught epsilon x. So the variation part is actually taken in the epsilon x part, and this E naught is extracted outside, and this E naught is basically the charge of electron that we measure, and this is this locked or frozen value, vacuum expectation value of this scalar field. Okay, now while constructing this theory, he actually considered all this thing, like the theory must reduce to known Maxwell theory for constant fine structure, constant alpha. And these are the assumptions he actually took in developing this varying electromagnetism. These are the like sort of assumption that you should respect when you construct new theories, like change in alpha. That is one assumption here, that change in alpha electromagnetic constant is dynamically generated by a scalar field. So that is the assumption he has taken. Now other assumptions like the theory must be Lorentz covariant, locally gauge invariant, causality, all these things are sort of, you have to do this when you construct theory. So he all did all these things, considered all these things, and constructed a consistent varying electromagnetic theory. And in this theory, the kinetic energy, so now epsilon is your field that varies on space time. That kinetic energy of epsilon will look like this. So this is not the standard kinetic energy that you are familiar with. Standard kinetic energy is half del mu phi, this kind of form. This is called canonical kinetic energy. In this form, you can actually easily get if you do this transformation. So from this transformation, you can make this kinetic energy looks like canonically normalized form. Okay. Now in this theory, the field strength tensor, that is modified little bit. Now this is the new field strength tensor. Earlier it was just del mu nu minus del nu mu, that antisymmetric tensor that you are familiar with. Now it is modified. This epsilon is introduced here. And if you consider this new gauge transformation, then you can actually show that this satisfies everything and gives you the correct Maxwell theory when you take alpha fine structure constant is a constant value, not variable. Okay, now you can actually write down the effective Lagrangian from this Bekenstein model. Then you end up with this Lagrangian. So the standard model part is here, and this new scalar that he introduced in the theory is basically this scalar phi, and the phi associated terms are shown here, and all the known standard model terms are not shown here. So this new terms that you can see here, these three are the new terms you will get here. Okay, now one can actually write down this term in a more convenient way or in a more standard way by using equation of motion. So that we are actually familiar with. So you see, this is the kinetic term of this scalar field phi half del mu phi square. And then a mass term is introduced here, half m phi, half m square phi square. This is the mass term for this scalar that is introduced here. And this is the usual kinetic term for photon. And then this new term with this scalar coupled with the field strength tensor. Then you see there are only two new parameters in this model. One is the mass of this scalar and the scale of this theory, lambda. So in that sense, this is a very economical model. You can actually test this model in collider. Only two three parameters are there. So this is the limit, current limit on the mass and the scale I showed in the previous slide here, this Lagrangian. So these two parameters, this is the current status of these two parameters. So this colored region are actually ruled out from the LHC experiment. and the white region is allowed. Okay, so how you can actually get this this kind of exclusion limit? So the left plot here, you see, this is the Higgs discovery plot. So Higgs particle was first discovered in the photon-photon channel. So you combine two photon that is coming out from the Higgs decay, and then you form the invariant mass of this two photon system. And you see this resonance bump here. And the position of the peak will give tell you the mass of the particle, which is 125 GeV here. And this is the way how Higgs was discovered in 2012. So similar diphoton data, so this is two photon data, you can actually use to construct this model, because this particle, if I go back to the previous slide, this phi mu scalar, that actually couples to two photon here. So if you expand this f mu nu term, then you get phi photon photon kind of vertex, okay, from this term. So it can actually decay to two photon, just like Higgs particle, but with different mass. It is not like same mass. So you will expect that at different location, you have this resonance bump. Then any non-observation of such resonances, you can actually recast in terms of the exclusion limit. So that's what is done here. So in this way, you can obtain this exclusion limit. Okay, now the similar idea you can also extend for varying electroweak theory. So in standard model, you have three gauge part, strong, weak, and electromagnetic. So you just first for the time being forget about the strong part, only the electroweak part. Then you have two independent gauge coupling, G1 and G2, or G or G prime. Here denoted G and G prime. And then you promote this coupling constant as dynamical fields like this, and you do the same thing here. Just it is straightforward extension, maybe a little bit complicated, but you can do the similar formalism here and construct this varying electroweak theory. And you can also test the signature of this very exotic model collider. And in a similar way, you can actually think of variation of all dimensionless constant present in the standard model. So other dimensionless constant like Yukawa coupling, so as I mentioned before, so these are like related to the mass of the particles, fermions. And these Yukawa couplings are dimensionless. You can also think of variation of Yukawa couplings in a similar fashion, and you get many such scalar in the model if you consider all such variations. But when we do some kind of experiment, so you not search for all these particles at a time. So whatever has lower mass, that will pop up fast, right? So you just test different possibilities in collider and try to see whether you can detect such kind of scalar in collider. So that is the target. You can actually rule out or discover this part, this theory, rule out or verify this theory. Okay. Now, in summary, probably already I'm running out of time. So this in summary, so as I said before, that varying coupling is not an oxymoron in this context. So it is actually pure, it has pure sense. It is not a nonsense concept. And this is natural in string theory. And as I also discussed, that there could be some interesting signatures of these peculiar models that you can test in actual experiment and you can verify it. Okay. And these variations, if you consider unification, that in unification, so you have only single coupling at very high scale. And from that coupling, other couplings originate. Okay. So as I mentioned at the beginning, so in the different context, you have different kind of signatures. So if you believe in grand unification, then you would expect different kind of signatures. So all such possibilities are there, and they will become more and more complicated if you consider more and more exotic or complicated models. So in summary, it is not a nonsense thing to consider the variation of couplings, and there could be many things one can do along this direction. One can do the collider type of analysis, cosmological analysis, various things you can do. Okay, so here I end my talk. Thank you.
Yeah, if someone from the audience has some question, you can unmute your mic and ask the question to the speaker. Yeah, so there's a question in the chat box. I'll read it out for you. The okay. question is asked by Tathagata Sarkar. It says, in the slide on Planck units, when actually do we take C equals G equals H equals 1, when we can already see these constants appear in the expressions for Planck length, Planck time and Planck mass? They shouldn't appear in the expressions if they are all 1, right?
No, that is true. But you, if you express other, like if you want to express some length, then you express in terms of the Planck length, in the sense that if you want to express velocity of any object, then you not say in meter per second, but you say this beta, which is V by C, that ratio. That ratio corresponds to the velocity of that particle. Okay, so in this way, so the C equal to G equal to H equal to 1 means this. So in that expression, you get the scale or the kilogram or second or meter, these things you get from this. And then with respect to this, what is your velocity, or what is your length, what is your time, or what is your other constants? You express in terms of that, relative to that. Okay. Is it clear, Tathagata? Okay.
Yeah, can I ask a question?
Yeah, yes, sure, definitely.
Yeah, Tanumay, it's a beautiful talk. So is there any proposal or something that this with cosmological time evolution, this C, velocity of light C has been, I mean, it is varying actually. Is there any proposal or anything?
Yes. So there is one famous proposal by Maguizu. At all. So he is actually constantly saying these things from 2 decades. So he is a British physicist, theoretical physicist, and he has this proposal of varying velocity of light.
Okay.
Because
there is some model called inflationary cosmological model that right. we cannot reach up to this origin, t is equal to origin, there is some fundamental limit.
Right.
Means in his model, can we get some explanation possibly from this what is this you mentioned now?
Yes, possible. But the thing is that so these are basically dimension full constant. Okay. Now actually you can write, as I said, if you probably understood already, so this dimension full constant, you can actually bring down to some dimension less constant by properly defining your unit system.
Yes.
Then you just consider the variation of this dimension less constant, not this dimension full constant.
Sure.
So it is equivalent description, of course. Okay.
Yes.
And then fine structure constant or any other dimension less constant, if you can actually detect this signature,
yes,
it actually equivalently saying that you can actually you have actually detected the variation of other constants. Okay, so in that sense.
Yeah.
Now the thing is that we don't know this mass of this scalar, if this kind of model at all there. Mm-hmm. Right, it is a free parameter.
Yeah.
Okay, it could be very very high mass, or it could be very low mass, not accessible in the collider.
Yes.
So only thing we can do that within our reach, we can actually verify. Below that or above that, we cannot.
Sure.
So in that sense, it is sort of you are actually searching something in dark.
So this is an old paper, huh?
Which one?
This is Maguido.
Yeah. This is, I think, 2000 around or even before.
Okay, sure. I think Subravalan has some question.
Subravalan has asked something. Is it that someone claims that C is not a fundamental constant because it is not dimensionless. However, dimension itself is a contrived concept. We might as well define a dimension for the fine structure constant. Then how do we know if something is truly independent? No, how you actually give the dimension to this fine structure? Actually, I should not go into this debate, because if you want to actually see this debate discussion, you can actually go to that paper. So this Michael Duff, he is actually saying these things. It is not actually my claim. I don't know, some argument he has given for this. Okay, so I would suggest that you you can read this paper if you are interested to see these arguments, because it is sort of open-ended thing. Like, depending on your interpretation, you can say various things. So he interpreted in some different ways, and there are other authors of that paper. So Michael Duff is saying that there is no dimensionful universal constant that belongs to this class C. Okay, the other author is saying two dimensionful constants are there, which is Veneziano, and another one is Okun. He is saying that three dimensionless constants are there. So among them, between these authors, there are debates. So if I go to that reference of that paper, so you see this paper, Duff, Okun, and Veneziano. So they have different opinions about this. Okay, any other question you can unmute and ask, we can discuss.
Any questions from the audience? Yeah, okay, sir. There are no questions, sir. That was a great talk. It was a very different and great talk, and it exposed us to many different areas in physics and many new ideas. So that was a great experience, and thank you for accepting the invitation and being here and presenting this talk today.
Yeah, thank you, Ravi Kiran. And I hope that I kept the level low such that this is actually understandable to this audience. I hope that you understood at least the basic parts of this talk.
Yeah, and sir. Okay. A small announcement to the audience. So tomorrow at 2:30 PM, we have a talk by Dr. Joey Mitra on modeling metals and insulators. An email for the same will be sent very shortly. So please do attend the talk. But just note that the talk is at 2:30 PM tomorrow. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Bye.